thank you very much. It's really a pleasure to be here, and thank you both to Stefan and to Marco for inviting me. And from what I've heard this morning, something about the vibe in the room tells me that you kind of understand what you're in for, but you don't quite understand what you're in for. So just to get a sense, I'd like a show of hands. How many of you think of yourself as leaders? Show of hands. Okay, two, three. Okay. What was actually written between the lines, and you didn't read it, for those of you who are not putting your hands up, is this is actually a leadership program. And the reason why it is a leadership program is because what you're being trained for is actually leadership 2.0, right? And you've been told how, you know, special you are because you're among the very, very small minority who got into this program. What you probably don't realize is that for people like me, in the kind of vantage I have of looking at so many different programs, you're in a very unique program. There are very few programs like this on the planet, so you're very, very privileged to actually experience this kind of a thing. It's going to change your life. And when Stefano mentioned that, you know, one of the most important things you're going to leave with is that diploma, the ASP diploma, I think it's really the most important experience you're going to have these 2 years. Now, I think you have a sense that you're probably quite privileged, you're very, very bright, etc. But what I'm going to try and convince you about is how important you are. And I don't mean in the personal way that you as a person are important, but you're going to fill a role that is of critical importance. So, and I'm going to make a case for it, okay? So you know, one of the other reasons why it's really a pleasure to be here is because for the rest of us who are from outside, Milan looks like the capital of design, right? You have had a legacy of design for as long as design has been an organized discipline and then some, right? So I come from a little place called Stanford, and we do a little bit of design as well, and I'd like to share what we are doing there, okay? But before I share that, I would actually like to frame a larger kind of a backdrop in terms of which I'm going to tell you what we are up to, right? So first and foremost, I think that it's a shared belief among a lot of people on the planet today, particularly among the leaders on the planet, whether they admit it or not, right to outside, is that we are entering an era of great turbulence. The world that you are going to be serving in your careers is going to be extremely dynamic, and change is going to be the only constant thing. The only thing you can depend on is that the next year will be very different from the one that has just gone by, okay? So why am I saying this? Let's just take a look at something you all know, but let me just list them down so that we can, you know, substantiate some of this. So some of the large meta trends that are occurring on the planet today is, first and foremost, you all know that our economic systems have shown themselves to be extremely fragile, right? They're very fragile, they're very delicate, and they're going through a lot of ups and downs, and there's a general sense that it is going to remain unstable for a very long period of time, given how we've set up our economies. The other thing that's very important for you all is that you're going to be participating in business economies, and the nature of business is changing, right? So in the early years, just because you were a big company and you had a large market share and you were a dominant player, meant that you could operate like, you know, the Borg, like in, you know, if for those of you who are Star Trek fans, you can just assimilate, right? And that rule has just gone out of the window, because you have new players that came from nowhere, people like Google and Facebook and so on, where they created entirely new paradigms, and completely established players who had the entire market were threatened in a matter of a small number of years. So Facebook, the IPO that's going to happen, is going to be probably the record IPO for anything in the tech industry. It's a $100 billion valuation that they might have. They came out from nowhere, right? The other thing that we have to look at is that we have very, very deep inequities on the planet. But meanwhile, there are large economies with very large populations that are growing in size in the middle class that they have. And it's changing consumption patterns. Now, we are already at 1.4 times the carrying capacity of the planet. It is artificially kept at such a low number because of the inequity, right? But now that we have an even deeper inequity and it's something that is not tolerable, it creates a really, really big conundrum, right? And then, of course, the traditional leaders of the economies are being threatened by new players. There are new players on the block. Countries such as India and China, the BRIC countries, are really dominant players, and they're changing your future, right? So I can bet you that all of you are going to be incredibly successful in your careers, and you're going to be in that elite class of 100,000 mile members, and you're going to be walking into the lounges at the airports because you're going to spend a lot of time on planes. Why? Because it's a global economy and you're going to have to jump in and out of planes a lot, right? Get used to that concept, right? And then, of course, if you look around in the world, we have some very deep political unrest, and not just as thought experiments, but in those areas where there are resources that shape the future of our civilization, right? Just think about where all the political resources, where the political unrests are. Either it's where a lot of oil resources are, or where there are, it's the lungs of the planet and a lot of forest reserves are, right? And then, of course, you are actually represented in the Gen Y and Gen Z populations. You are all Gen Y people. The sensibilities of your generation are very different from the sensibilities of the people around which the dominant fields have shaped themselves. So I don't think that our university systems are really understand how to train people like you, right? So our university systems and our education systems are also somewhat broken, and we are scrambling to meet the needs of the future, right? And then, of course, the bedrock of civilization, things such as energy and food and water, the futures are extremely uncertain and are very grim. There are no pretty pictures out here, right? And we are, climate change is a reality. It's already happening, and the effects of them are already being borne. And they are also being borne by people who have the short end of the stick. The extremely poor in the world are seeing the harshest realities because there's a trickle-down effect of what people have to deal with, and it's already being faced right now, right? And then you zoom back even further back, and we have mass extinctions going on that are 10 to 100 times bigger than any mass extinction since the dinosaurs went extinct, right? We have the fish are dying. Like, there's a very massive depopulation of fish in the oceans. We are losing 20 to 30,000 species in just the forested biomes, right? Not even the entire planet. So we are facing some really big issues. And one of the things that we find ourselves in is the degree to which the kind of civilization we have today is interdependent and interconnected. Now, this is why, and I'm really apologize for painting such a grim picture, but this is the world we're entering. But let's look at it in another way, right? And this is what I'm gonna do. What does it take? What is the kind of person does it take to play in this playing field? And I'm actually now pointing to you and saying, you're the kind of person it takes, right? So now I'm going to give you a second chance. How many of you think you're leaders, right? And you better all raise your hands, right? You see why, right? You're all leaders. You start thinking about yourselves as leaders because you're going to be in positions of leadership in very little time. Get used to the idea, okay? Now, another big kind of huge big fact that we have to worry about, anyone know what this number is about, right? This is the number we rolled over just a few months ago, right? And just to put it this in context, this is the population of the planet, right? It took from the beginning of, we added a billion in the last 12 years, right? 1 billion. And it took us from the beginning of time to 1804 to add the first billion, right? It's something to think about. If somebody had told me that the planet of Earth is being attacked by aliens, that might have been easier news, because maybe the aliens are friendly, right? But this is a really serious issue, right? But we have a really big problem, which is that our dominant fields, science, engineering, law, business, etc., were all formed at a time when the challenges were different. The boundary conditions of those fields were something very different, right? So what we need to do is actually ask ourselves whether the thing that has got us into this big hole, if the same kind of thinking is going to dig us out of that hole or make that dig a bigger hole for ourselves, right? So I think what we have as an issue to face is that we need to actually escape the entire way in which we think and create new ways of thinking. We actually need to escape the way we currently think and create completely new ways of thinking in order to meet the future, right? Now let me pause there for a minute and change the scene, right? I come from the design field and I represent the design field, but the design field in its short history, it has been at once a very old field, because anything that is not nature at some level is designed, right? So all around you is some intervention that you know some designer in some form has made, right? But meanwhile, the design as an organized field has not been around for too long as a generalized field. And there is a huge big change taking place, and I'd like to talk about that a little bit. But there's a reason why I'm juxtaposing these issues, because there is a tie between the fact that we are going into turbulent futures and also the reasons for and also the promise, the opportunities in the way the design field is growing and is undergoing a revolution. So a little bit about this term called design thinking, right? The title of the talk was design thinking. So what is this thing? What is this design thinking, right? So all of you are familiar with the fields of design, interior design, architecture, furniture design, et cetera, product design, right? Now they're very different from each other, but there are certain fundamental similarities between them. And in the last 10 years or so, no, I would say more, about 13 or 14 years, there's a very interesting thing that happened in the design field. People started extracting the thinking that designers did and articulating what it is that designers are doing and offered it to the world in a way such that design thinking, that type of thinking, A, could be used for non-traditional ends, so not just design of products, not just design of interiors, but other things, other types of challenges. But two, it could be transferred to people who did not necessarily have the design label, and as long as they thought like designers, that would be fine. And this is particularly important because at some level, if you're human, and most of the people in this room, I can't speak for everybody, is probably Homo sapiens. If you are, then you're a designer at some level, right? Because there are parts of your brain you cannot undo, and that makes you a designer, right? Now, this thing, this design thinking that when it got extracted out, it started getting used in very many different ways that were non-traditional, right? It started getting used to create new experiences, right? Completely new experiences in designing systems that did not exist before, in coming up with strategies, and some of what I'm going to talk about today is going to be about the strategic intent that design can have. It is about coming up with interventions to more complex challenges, not just solving a problem, but solving a larger challenge, right? And also having the ability, the capacity, but also the courage to come up with visions for the future. And instead of creating your next steps in terms of what you're doing today, creating very aggressive and aspirational visions and marching back from that in order to figure out what the next step should be, right? Reversing it. So then, suddenly, if you look at this and squint your eye a slightly different way, a design thinker is actually in the business of not just reacting to the future, but creating the future, right? So all of you, I'd love for you to recognize the fact that you're actually now going to be, you're training yourself to be leaders, and you're in not just responding to the future, but you're now in those positions where you're going to be shaping futures. That's what your job is, right? That's what you're going to get paid to do, right? Now, this is another thing that's interesting that's happening, which is that everything that's happening in design thinking maps beautifully to what is also coming up as this other way of doing leadership. So it's not the same kind of leadership that came out of our, you know, our definition of business, which came from defining businesses in terms of how the military works, or like industrial, the Industrial Revolution. At that time, a lot of organizational systems got formulated based on replacing human capacity with machine capacity, and a lot of our concepts of leadership come from that point. But that entire way of thinking about leadership is crumbling, and so a lot of you might still be think that someday when you're 50 years old, you might become a leader. Wrong. 5 years from now, you'll be leaders. Actually, right now, you could be a leader, right? Because the way you operate as a leader with leadership 2.0 is changing, right? So in short, what is design thinking? Here's one definition I'm throwing out. It's an approach that frames the problem creatively. So it's not just solving the problem, but framing what the problem is in the first place. And it generates innovative solutions, strategies, systems, and paradigms, which are not just in one sector, but it's at the meeting points of very many different domains, right? And that essentially is a short stab at something quite complex, which we call design thinking, right? But all of you are going to learn this. You're going to become experts at this, and you're going to be teaching others, because part of your role is not just going to be using it, but you're going to be teaching, okay? Now, why is the design mind, this design thinker, why is it different? A little bit at a fundamental level, it's worth understanding this, which is that the human mind, if it's given a familiar problem, right? If you're given a familiar problem, if you've seen the problem before, then your mind has a heuristic for it. It already knows how to operate with it, and it shunts it to one part of your brain, and it goes to the neocortex. It's the front part of your brain. It's called neocortex because, you know, it was formed later in evolution, etc. So a lot of executive thinking takes place there, right? But if you haven't seen the problem before, if you're given a problem and you haven't seen it before, immediately, if you strap someone with sensors, different parts of your brain light up. And there are like many other centers, but loosely that system is called the limbic system, right? And there are entirely different cognitive systems, cognitive modalities going on in those parts of your brain. And all of you have it, right? So right now, you all came down and sat on these chairs, and you knew, even though you might not have seen this exact design of a chair, you looked at it and you said, that looks like a chair. I think it'll bear my weight. I can sit on it, right? Now, right now, for example, if this building was on fire and the doors were locked, you would find that your limbic system would kick in, and you'd find completely different ways of getting out of this room. You'd suddenly realize that there's a glass window out here, and you'd suddenly realize that this is not a monitor, it's something that can break a glass window, right? You would actually redesign the purpose of this thing. And that would be a limbic system at work, because you'd reframe the problem, right? Now, So the different cognitive modes going on in your brain, there are a couple that are very, very popular in, and you're taught that in school, and that is deductive and inductive thinking, right? So deductive thinking says, postulate something, and then it tests the hypothesis, right? So you postulate something, and then you create a test, and it relegates that to a state of fact, to a new state of understanding that allows you to create another hypothesis. So let's say that some theoretical physicist says that carbon nanotubes will collapse and will remain collapsed because of van der Waals forces. That's some theoretical physicist who said that, but then the experimental physicists go and put synthesize carbon nanotubes and put them in a scanning electron microscope or some such thing, and they realize that, oh, actually they do ask flatten, and they prove it out, right? Inductive thinking is like basically you see 100 crows that are black, and you say that all crows are black based on the fact that you've seen 100 crows that are black, right? You extrapolate based on pattern recognition. Until you go to Africa and see a crow that is white and black, it's a pied crow, that hypothesis holds true, right? You think that all crows are black, right? Now, the other two are actually much more interesting because it really maps to what designers are given license to do. And abductive thinking is the use of your imagination to see possibilities that might not exist today. And a scientist might not want to go that far. Actually, scientists do a lot of abductive thinking as well. But it's the kind of thinking a detective might do when they go into a room and there's a dead body and there are a few clues, and they say, you know, this is a poor neighborhood. What is this guy doing with $400 shoes? Maybe this guy was having an affair with this guy's wife. And like they start making up stories that would explain the facts, right? They're using their imagination to see possibilities, and they see many solutions one after the other. And then in a probabilistic way, they say that, you know what, I think this might be what might have happened. Let's look for more clues that will explain it, right? So what they're looking for is somewhat qualified by what their imagination and their probabilistic thinking is telling them might have happened. That's abductive thinking. Retrodictive thinking is very similar to that, but it's even more powerful. It is you, people, all of us, have the capacity to do this. We imagine rules that don't exist yet, and then given those rules, we imagine what kind of behaviors would come out of it, right? So when you are planning a big party for your friend, and it's a surprise party, you think of all the things you do such that it's a really successful surprise party. That's retroductive thinking, okay? You're using your power of imagination and creating some rules, and once you have those rules, then behavior will change. Now, this is particularly relevant because part of what, as innovators, you're being asked to do is, in business, what's called creating blue ocean strategies. The difference between red ocean strategies and blue ocean strategies is red ocean strategies are businesses trying to compete in a water that's red with blood because everybody's going after the same food, and the name of the game is cost reduction or better marketing, right? Blue ocean strategies is where, because the company is very innovative in its strategy, it creates something that doesn't exist before, creates a new market, for a while, before people catch up, it has a place where there are no competitors, right? So in business strategy, this has become a fetish in terms of how you think about creating new markets and expanding your markets rather than carving up the markets between you and your competitors, right? So these are all the things that are happening in design. So let me tell you about the kind of challenges that designers are being asked to solve, right? And these are things that have spanned the last 10 years or so. So a big technology company might come to these kind of design thinkers, and instead of saying, design me a new camera or a new computer, they might ask a much bigger question. What is the future of mobile computing, right? So imagine now that you're the project manager on this project, and somebody slaps down, you know, $500,000 and gives you not 2 years like you have, but 10 weeks, right? And you're supposed to come up with an answer about what is the future of mobile technology, because, and you know, $500 million worth of research funding is going to get changed based on what you come up with, right? That's going to be your task. These are the kind of questions you're going to be asked. Or a company that is already known for its innovation, but because there's such a hunger for innovation and being able to create new markets and outperform normative systems, you're going to not just be asked to come up with innovative answers, but you're going to be asked to teach people how to be innovative. So you're going to have to say, how do you transform organizations where they already understand something about innovation, but you're going to have to teach them how to be much more innovative, right? So this is the kind of question that people like me have had to deal with for the last 10 years, right? But we've also had to deal with things like this, which is a mining company that has been in existence for 200 years, saying that how can we enter a country without creating a civil war, right? And the same set of tools that you use to design a camera comes really handy with questions such as this, right? Or something like this, where you know we have fleets and fleets of cars, hundreds of millions of cars, and each of those cars represents a tremendous investment in embodied energy. Embodied energy is the amount of energy it takes all the way from mining the ore to manufacturing the entire thing. It takes a whole lot of energy. And that energy is embodied in the object, right? And now each car represents such a big embodied energy investment, even if you had a revolution in car technology. Supposing somebody came up with an internal combustion engine with a very, very different efficiency number, which is actually really hard to do because we are in diminishing returns right now, we still have to figure out how to take this entire fleet and change it around, right? But if you reframe the problem, you can actually get a solution like this, which is the zip car. A zip car in the US is a business that essentially is a way in which you can get a car for the period of time you need it, right? It's like a library for books. It's a library for cars. Now, you might think it odd because all of us are trained to think in terms of wanting to own cars. But most of my students, they have Zipcar models. They have Zipcar accounts. And they think I'm crazy because to want to own a car. They say, why do you want to own a car? You can only own one car or maximum two cars. We own an entire fleet of cars. When we need to go to Home Depot to buy lumber, we have a pickup truck. And when we are going on a hot date, we have a convertible. Like, why would you want to own one car when you can own all these things, right? So these people, the founders of Zipcar, completely reframed what ownership means, and they've made they're growing really quickly. And this is a student project, and these are some of the top people in some of the car companies, international car companies like Volkswagen and Audi, who are looking at this car because this car is actually an electric car that students built in 10 weeks. Drive-by-wire electric car, but it was asking this big question about how suburbia in the US breaks communities. And it's very energy expensive because just to buy a can of milk, you have to get into a car and drive the way the cities are designed in the US. So they're actually asking, what can we do where you don't have to own a car? And it's very different, and you might actually meet your neighbor rather than going into a tunnel, getting out of your home, and emerging at your work. Now, let me take you through a project that students, just like you did, and this is a simple project, but I think it's iconic of the power of the process. So there is a really, really large challenge in the planet right now, which is that of the 130 million babies that are born, 4 million of them die in the first 28 days. And the main reason why they die is because of premature birth, right? So babies that are born premature and underweight. And the question to this, the team, team of four students, multidisciplinary, most of them with business or engineering or design backgrounds, right? They came together and said that, can you design an incubator which costs upwards of $30,000 for a hundredth of the cost, right? So can you design it for, instead of $30,000, can you design it for $300, right? Now, these students went to, they realized that most of these deaths were taking place in places like places like India and places like Bangladesh. And so they went to India to these small regional hospitals expecting to understand what's going to happen. And they, contrary to their expectations, they found that these hospitals actually have incubators. Somehow, they found the money, they've been gifted incubators and so on. Does anyone see anything funny in this picture? They're empty. Where are all these babies that are dying, right? That is the first thing that they ask, where are all the babies, right? First of all, they didn't think that these people have the incubators. They find that they have incubators, but no babies. So they went to the villages where all these the babies were dying, and they found that the families to which the babies were being born, they did not have the wherewithal to take the babies to the towns, right? They had other mouths to feed. They were day laborers, etc. They were not particularly educated, so they didn't even understand the existence of an incubator, and in any case, they couldn't afford it. So this is the point at which they had a crucial and very important development in their project. They reframed the problem. They reframed the problem saying that we do not need a cheaper incubator, that is $300. We need a super cheap, for $25, baby warmer without all the functionalities that happen in an incubator, such as UV lights and so on and so forth, and something that would work without electricity, right? They completely changed the problem. And so they came back and they did a lot of brainstorming. Bottom left picture, they're brainstorming and generating many ideas. They built upwards of 200 prototypes. They built prototypes like there was no tomorrow, right? They just came up with huge numbers of very crude but very rapidly generated concepts, and they tested them. And they went to the grocery store and bought stuff and so on, and they came upon this idea that you could actually make something that looked like a sleeping bag, and you could put a little insert in it that had a mix of waxes that if you put it in hot water, it would melt, and then the latent heat that is of recrystallization could keep the baby warm for a long time, right? It was one of the many, many concepts. But they prototyped this thing, and as you can see, for all of you in the room that are engineers, this is not rocket science. It's a good idea, but it's not like as complex as a jet turbine or some such thing. But they didn't stop there. They took their prototypes back to the village, and they realized that there were all these other stakeholders that they did not realize were stakeholders, and all of them represented things that could go wrong in the last mile problem, which is you can have a great concept, but in the last mile, it could actually die. So they came back with all these new insights that they had to change, such as putting a window because the local health official wants to see that the baby's breathing. And then they had to make it such that there was an indicator that was language independent so that the baby would not get scalded and overheated. All these things, right? Then there were babies they were so small that they could fit on your palm. So how can a baby not slip inside and asphyxiate? So there was another way in which they could make it smaller, right? So all these things. So they came up with the prototype like this. But they didn't stop there. The class ended. These guys formed a company, had a tiny little rental room in Palo Alto, started a company, raised enough seed funding to go. They all moved to Bangalore. And now they have full VC funding, they have orders up to Wazoo, they are working with GE, who's distributing their things. They have huge numbers of orders from very many different countries. They have multiple product lines. They're doing really well, right? So this is a very simple story of four students just like you, no different, right? Who just followed a 20-week process, and they got, they reframed the problem. But if you take a step back and see what they did, right, this is a very, very simplified view of what they did. They first and foremost did not take the brief that their professors gave them as too literally. They went and found out the insights for themselves, right? And they came up with very, very important insights, very, very human-centered and system-centered insights. They completely reframed the problem, which is the biggest thing that they did, right? Now, and then they came up with many conceptual prototypes. So on one hand, that little prototype, the design, is not that impressive in terms of design. But on the other hand, the design of the incubator has been unchanged in a fundamental way for 130 years, right? So, you know, why is it that this solution eluded the medical community that is also trying to work on infant mortality for decades, right? It is that is the power of the process, right? You can reframe what the problem is in the first place. So let's look at some other examples. These are other students from Stanford. This guy is a chemical engineering student. He had a strong point of view. He basically had the point of view that all these big companies such as Procter & Gamble and so on, they make these big detergent bottles and they ship them around in the world. But most of what they're shipping is water. And they did a back of the envelope calculation of how much energy goes into shipping water all around the world. And they came up with these astronomical numbers that were just sheer criminal. And besides, they felt that all of these chemicals were formed at a time when people wanted to completely do away with all germs. So there was a fashion of getting harsher and harsher chemicals. But now, the sensibility was that chemicals were our enemy. We were loading our bodies with beyond our carrying capacity of very toxic chemicals. So they decided that, look, we don't want to ship extra water. We want all the chemicals to be organic and vegetable-based. And we are going to save on the packaging by using the kind of plastics that are recyclable and from recycled material. And they came up with this product. Now, again, students your age, right, came up. They're taking on Procter & Gamble, right? They're basically going head-to-head against Procter & Gamble. Guess what happens? Not only are they successful, in 6 months' time, the big players are scrambling, and they have products like this, which look really tiny and on the shelf next to it. They're changing the entire environment on detergents, right? Now, that is creating a change that translates to tons, literally tons, of non-renewable fuel, right? Now, here's another example. These people, Tony Fadell and company, they came out of Apple, having designed, they were in the iPhone team, many, many of the Apple products. They led those, this guy was in those teams, and he's come out, and he is now designing a thermostat with a big difference. He is actually recognizing that the information layer that is now afforded by sensors can change behavior to the point where you can actually reduce huge amounts of energy. Research shows that you can actually reduce 10 to 15% of energy usage just by changing behavior. And this is a really smart thermostat. It learns what you do, and it figures out all these heuristics as to how to get you to save energy. And I'm working on the same area myself. I know that there's a lot of research that shows that the right kind of goal setting and feedback and so on can be extremely effective in reducing energy. Okay, so let's again, you know, the word design conjures up so many things in our minds. So some of you have come from design backgrounds, some of you from engineering backgrounds, but let's unpack this a little bit, right? So design definitely has, over the time, has been attributed to serving the senses, right? Beautiful things, highly aesthetically pleasing, etc., right? It also serves functional needs. Of course, in this case, I'll argue that this is also serving the senses. It's one of the most beautiful, you know, teapots that you've ever imagined, right? This is fantastic. It's a really, really fantastic piece of design, right? I have one of those, and if my house is burning, I'd probably, you know, run for that before I run out of the house. I like it that much, right? But design also does unexpected things. It does, you know, it delights. It creates these moments where you look at it and it puts a smile on your face. But, you know, design also advances technology. All these things that we have, the cell phone in your pocket, et cetera, is a highly converged technological device that has taken thousands and tens of thousands of person hours of engineering design and development. This is an example of a professor from Stanford, Mark Kukoski, who has created a glue that doesn't look like any kind of a glue that you know of. It emulates the pads that geckos have under their feet and makes such tiny contact that it uses the van der Waals forces to grab onto surfaces. So he has a little mechanical gecko that climbs up a glass sheet, right? It's a new kind of glue. But it also creates affordances. It gives us ways in which to operate that are completely new. It has, you know, it creates, it gives you an ability to do completely new things that someone 10 years ago or 100 years ago could not imagine, right? So I was flying in an aircraft that was probably 7 miles altitude, and all I could think of was, why can't they make coffee well, right? But meanwhile, 200 years ago, somebody would have killed for the opportunity to have seen the Earth from that distance, right? And we now take it for granted. And at the time flight was invented, just over 100 years ago, aluminum was more expensive than gold, right? And now we climb into an aluminum beast, all 350 of us, and go up. You know, this thing weighs 350 tons, and we go up to 7 miles without thinking about it. That's how quickly we change things, right? And then, of course, design has a lot to do with creating completely new business ecosystems. I talked about this. This is, you know, you all know about how fantastic this case story is, so I don't need to go into it. But there are other things that it does, right? Design is in the design thinking, and you as designers, as design thinkers, are going to propose interesting visions. So this one is a local one. I don't know if it's completed or not, but it holds the world's record for rooftop solar generation. It has 18 megawatt of solar capacity on a roof. It's not only creating 18 megawatts of energy. It's an icon for every architect who has to now think about how much energy their building is going to generate. Right? It proposes visions. But we also do this. We actually propose radical alternatives. Like, this thing is actually an amazing, a large wind machine, if anyone who's come close to it, is truly an amazing thing, right? Look at the size of that rotor, right? It's like longer than a football field. But we also do this. We take challenges and we intervene with it. So this is the hippo roller, which again reframed the challenge. It looked at all these women in countries like Africa and India carrying water on their heads for 8 kilometers, 10 kilometers, just for the day's supply of water. And they said, why are they carrying it if they could roll it, right? And then you're not restricted by the capacity that you can carry on your head. You can get more water. It frees up time. You can generate employment some other way, right? You could use the water for mixed use. You could grow a cash crop. You could send your children to school, right? Changes, it intervenes with a larger problem. This is not the best design interface, but research shows that this kind of an interface in the Prius, the fact that you're giving feedback is known to change driving habits in ways that really saves energy. This is something worth paying attention to. The fact that human behavior can be modified in ways that are profound, right, is in your hands now. And that's a really interesting to think about if you think of all consumption as being two sides of a rectangle, where on one hand are technological alternatives, but the other one is the per capita consumption of resources. You might change it. So this is another thing, which through you see larger systems, and suddenly you have a country like Germany, or maybe even out here, where for an outsider, when you come in, you feel as if you need a PhD in how to sort your garbage, right? But those people might grumble about it, but an entire population is doing it. But meanwhile, if you go to where I live, it's absolutely stupid how much garbage we put in the landfill, right? There is no system to really catch the colossal amount of waste that we have. So you're actually intervening at a very large system-wide thing where where you're creating new ways in which people are operating in their homes, in their kitchens, but it's tied to a larger way in which materials are flowing and getting reused. But this is something I'd like to talk about, which is design, ask questions, right? This is a design of a building where native vegetation comes right over the building, and it's asking a question. It's asking a question about why we are willing to lose the ecological value of the land that we build on, right? It doesn't necessarily say that every building can be built like this, but it is asking that question. And so one of the things that design really does, and it's your job as design thinkers, is to uncover the questions that conventions and mediocrity have covered. That is our job, right? It's our job to identify the right question, because everything begins from asking the right questions. So in the case of that, the baby warmer, the big question mark in the center was not how to create a cheaper incubator. The question mark in the center was how do you save babies from dying? That was the better question, right? So ask the right question, then things are going to fall out from there. But the other thing that you do is we talked about ambiguity today. You're walking into incredibly ambiguous situations, and it is your charge to cut cubes out of fog. Take a really ambiguous situation where there is no clarity, everything is really complex, and go through a process and go through a certain kind of leadership, and you make something tangible at the end of it. It's a tangible intervention that is going to make a difference. So a lot of this is about making this very important distinction between what is the right thing to do and how to do it right. Now, a lot of the world is all about doing things right without first having asked the question whether it should be done in the first place, right? And our processes are all about asking that question and even asking the question whether you should do it at all or not, right? And then going about doing it right once you've identified it. So what is occurring now is that we are now playing at a systems level. We are not just dealing with it at the level of the artifact, right? We are dealing with it at a larger system and asking what should we do at the systems level and how should we implement it at the systems level, right? And we are working on both sides of the equation. We are actually innovating in defining the problem and innovating on the solution domain, so both, and actually going back and forth, because taking a crack at the solution domain is a brilliant way of interrogating what the problem is. It's when you try to solve a problem that you understand much better what the problem is, and then you should reshape the problem and go back to trying and solving it in an iterative manner, right? So with all this, what we are actually seeing is that the economy is changing. It's actually, there's been a lot of talk about that we are in the experience economy, but in my belief, we are actually going into a transformation economy. We are actually being asked to transform at a very large scale, and just as the experience economy gave us a new field, which is experience design, the transformation economy is giving us a new field, which is transformation design. It might not get called that, but you as design thinking leaders are going to have to think of yourself as interventionists, right? And the reason is because we are living in the challenges that you're going to be dealing with are going to have this backdrop of extremely complex interlaced situations with many different constraints working back and forth with many feedback loops. And you're going to be asked to do systemic transformations, go in and design systems. Now, how do you do this, right? This is not easy. Right? Systems are not particularly easy to design. So if you need to design, change things at the level of the ecosystem, you need to come up with completely different platforms. And you need techniques and platforms for transdisciplinary co-creation. Now, transdisciplinary co-creation, this is a word you're going to hear over and over in the next few years of your life. You're going to be using that word a lot. So get used to it. Now, but it's very important to understand what the difference is, right? So collaboration is our people, and a typical company is actually fairly collaborative. Different people do different things. Marketing people do something, sales people do something, engineers are designing. They're all collaborating towards getting a product out, right? So this is something that's fairly well understood. You understand each other's constraints and you work together and use your own expertise really well. Co-creation is a little different. You take experts and you surround a challenge with experts. You don't make the expertise the center, you make the challenge the center, and you look at how can we solve this problem together. It's slightly different, right? But the big difference is that in collaborative systems, you're still working within your own system. You're still working in the way you were trained, in the rubric that you have, and within the silo that you belonged in. And you're somehow contributing to the larger thing. But transdisciplinary systems are fundamentally different. You have the confidence to leave the comfort zone of your own field and create a new rubric. You're creating a new space where a completely new set of possibilities exist. So this is what we need to be doing in looking at the kind of challenges that we are facing. And why do we need to do this? It's because you need this disciplinary parallax to even understand what the real dimension of the challenge is. Because each of us from our discipline carries a perceptual lens where we can only see one angle of the challenge, right? But if you surround the challenge with people who look at it from different angles, you actually, with parallax, you can see what the different dimensions of the challenge is, right? You get what I'm saying, right? So why is this really important? Because we need to think in terms of paradigms. A paradigmatic change is a very special case of a solution. So let me tell you what a paradigm is, right? This is the graph of a 100-year record of high jumps, right? So there were four different styles in the history of high jumps: the scissors kick, the Western roll, the straddle, and the Fosbury flop, right? And you see how with each change in the style, there's a discontinuity in the graph. That's when things changed, right? But there's two very important things that are worth noting about this one, which is that right now, for the people who are training for the next Olympics, the regular Olympics, not the senior Olympics, regular Olympics, right? The number of people who are training with the scissors kick is exactly zero, right? Something that used to be the norm is just history, right? But the even more important thing to note is that from the point of the scissors kick, if somebody had talked about Fosbury flop, it would have looked like utter madness, right? You're running up to the pole and jumping with your back to the pole, your feet are the last thing that clear and you're falling on your head. It doesn't make sense, right? When you demonstrate something with a very, very different level of efficacy, that becomes the norm, right? So it goes back to creating that blue ocean strategy where you're coming up with a completely new paradigm that rewrites the rule books, right? And that is one of the challenges that we have. So what we do in transdisciplinary and trans-agency setups is you actually don't think in terms of your field, you actually think in terms of the challenge you're going after, and surround it with a judicious collection of disciplines and attack it like that. So this experience that you're going to have of working with people unlike with not your own background on a challenge, it's a fantastic bit of training which very few people have the privilege of having. So you're getting trained in something which literally represents the leadership of tomorrow. You're actually going to become very, very good at it. So how else are we trying to create the environment where this kind of thing happens? At Stanford, we have a very, very collaborative way in which we do design. This is a boot camp in a design class with lots of students who are working in tight clusters who are doing some kind of a design exercise. Now, if for people who were like me, who were trained in architecture, we would not have recognized this as design. Because in architecture, we worked alone with our own sheet of paper or on our own computers, and you went and showed your work to your professor at the end of the quarter, but there wasn't this kind of thing happening where you were co-creating it with other people. It's a very dynamic, very, very powerful way of working, right? But these are the other things we try to reinforce in our curricular structure, in our pedagogical structure. And first of all, one of them is identity. We want students to think of themselves as leaders and change agents, which is why I want you to think of yourself as a leader and change agent. What are you going to change? How can you enforce your, how can you leverage your leadership position, and how can you create those positions for yourself, right? Then solving difficult challenges over and over and using the process over and over gives you creative confidence. You no longer look at a project brief or a challenge, and just because you can't figure it out right there, are you fazed by it? You're not afraid of it. You get dropped in the deep end of a really challenging project, and you say, okay, I have a very powerful project process. I don't know what the answers are, but we'll figure it out. We'll work together and we'll figure it out. And that confidence is a very, very good thing, because otherwise you just stop because the problem looks so big and you don't know which end to hold it by, right? This is, again, very important, which is it's not just about the elegance of the solution or any such thing. It's about what is the impact you're going to make. What are you transforming? What are you changing, right? If you think of your life as a 0x0, where you're born with nothing and you die with nothing, what is that X, right? And in that process, in that individual project, what is that X? What is the biggest impact it can have, and impact in a way that is holistic, so that you don't make a disproportionate a cost where, because your eye was turned away from some other cost, which is how most of our developments take place, right? They're very myopic. That's what's wrong with our definitions of success and growth, et cetera, which is that while we grow, we cause more problems than the good that we do, right? So, and then there is this process mindedness. If you are, as you're solving your projects in this program, if you take a little bit of a meta-level view and step back and look at yourselves and think, so what is the process that we are using, and get good at the process itself such that you could use it for any project, it would actually come really, really handy, because someone could then change the project for you, and you'd be able to do it all, because it's a very powerful process. So understanding how to choreograph the process and how to bring in a process is one of the key aspects of this leadership 2.0. You could be surrounded by people who are 30 years older than you and are wearing $3,000 suits, and you could just be, someone who's 24 or 25, and you could change the dynamic in the room such that really interesting things come out of it, okay? And then, of course, this thing of how do you collaborate in extremely radical ways, right? Completely radical ways, such that the fact that you can think together, you leave the limitations of each of them and you have a gestalt of how you think, right? So you work together, you create proposals together, you break the team up into people who are trying to propose and people who are trying to break the system. There are many, many different ways in how you do radical collaboration, and this is also fractal in nature. You could do it between two people. You can actually do it in your own mind, because if you're different people, you can actually play them back and forth in very interesting ways, but it works at the level of entire big organizations or multi-dimensional, multi-agency systems. It's a very interesting topic all in itself. Now, in closing, I want to actually talk a little bit about this thing that we are doing. So we have something called the Change Labs. And this is trying to understand how do you create large-scale transformation. So the three things that we have are, we are, in order to understand what this large change is, we are trying to understand this transdisciplinary tools and heuristics for it. How do you actually create that? We are combining fields in interesting manners. We are incubating in new initiatives, which might be limited in terms of resources and scale, but are iconic of this new way of thinking. And then we are realizing that this is not to be localized. People who are thinking along these lines need to create a network, a global network, which is one of the reasons I'm here, because I see something very interesting happening out here. And one of the reasons I'm here is because I feel that you're a very interesting node in that kind of a network. and I'm hoping to collaborate with you all. I bet that in the next 2-3 years, there'll be at least a few of you who will, you know, I will want to deal with, right? So this thing of rapid transformation has two components. Not only is it changing in of paradigms, like I talked about, creating completely new paradigms. It is also thinking about what makes it diffuse really quickly, what makes it spread really quickly. And if you do it right, you bring the diffusion system onto your plate when you're innovating, and you're thinking about how it's going to spread while you're innovating, right? So one of the ways we are thinking about this is a very, very powerful combination, which is combining behavioral sciences and behavioral economics with design thinking. It's a very powerful combination. We are actually combining design thinking with many things, but this is one of the more interesting ones. And so what we're looking at is, you know, these completely new paradigms, looking at diffusion systems and how do you get adoption rates to be very quickly, to be very rapid. Enabling systems and enabling ecosystems so that many players can actually create a slightly altered way in which we are behaving. A very different way in which to leverage social capital, because it's one of the biggest capitals we have right now in a world that is going to be impoverished in other resources. And then how do you create economic engines that are really novel? How do you create completely new types of economic engines, right? And the simple way, like, to remember is that, you know, we form multi-stakeholder innovation teams. We uncover really deep insights, very, very deep insights, whether it's through ethnography work to understand the humans or look at the system in interesting ways in order to figure out where the leverage points are. And we innovate both at the very high level, but with a view of coming up with something tangible that we can actually intervene with soon. And then having an iterative process, because we don't believe that we can sit and figure it all out. It's the act of trying it out that is going to help us understand how to operate and create the new systems, et cetera. Okay, so with that, I'm going to, you know, end there and pass it on to Luisa. Right? Thank you very much.